heat, light and sound. Heat, light and sound are all forms of energy. Heat can be transferred by radiation, conduction and non-convection. Visible light can be produced, reflected, refracted and separated into light of various color. Sound is created by vibration and cannot travel through a vacuum. Pitch is determined by the vibration rate of the sound source. Let's discuss about further. So what is heat? Heat is a type of energy. It occurs when molecules start moving. Do you know about it? The faster the molecule move, the greater the heat. And the slower the molecules move, the lower the heat. Heat is the form of energy that is transferred between systems or objects with different temperature, flowing from high temperature system to the low temperature system, also referred to as heat energy or thermal energy. Heat is measured in joules. Heat flow or the rate at which heat is transferred between systems has the same unit as power, energy per unit time. Let's understand the temperature. Heat is measured by temperature. Temperature really measures how much heat, energy and object has. There are two main scales for measuring temperature. They are Celsius and Fahrenheit. Most countries around the world use the Celsius scale. Devices used for temperature measurement are different thermometers, pulse or digital thermometers. Thermometers contain any other fluid. Temperature is directly proportional to an expansion of mercury. As soon as the temperature increases, it causes fluid to expand. Hence, the temperature can be measured by measuring the volume of fluid. There are many temperature measurement devices available, such as thermocouples, resistive temperature devices, thermistors, etc. Heat can directly be related to temperature. If the temperature of object is high, it has more energy, and if the temperature is low, then it has less energy. Let's learn more about it. On the Celsius scale, water freezes at 0 degree and boils at 100 degrees. On the Fahrenheit scale, water freezes at 32 degrees and boils at 212 degrees. So, Celsius degrees are larger than Fahrenheit. And do you know about it? There is a third scale used for measuring temperature. This is known as the Kelvin scale. The Kelvin scale is used to measure extremely cold and hot temperature. The history of Kelvin scale is, in 1848, Lord Kelvin defined an absolute scale based on the Carnot cycle, which was named after him as Kelvin's absolute temperature scale. In Kelvin scale, the zero point is 273.15 below that of the Celsius scale. So, the standard measure of temperature in the international system of unit is the Kelvin. Let's discuss about who invented Celsius and Fahrenheit scale. The Celsius scale is named after a Swedish scientist, Anders Celsius. He lived about 300 years ago and developed the Celsius scale we use. And the Fahrenheit scale is named after a Polish-born scientist, Daniel Gabriel Fahrenheit, who also lived about 300 years ago. He invented the thermometer and developed the Fahrenheit scale. Let's discuss about how thermometer works. This is a thermometer. It measures temperature. Understanding how thermometer works will help you understand how heat works. Inside the glass of thermometer is liquid. For a long time, liquid mercury was used. When the liquid is cold, its molecules stay close together. This means the liquid does not take up much space and stays near the bottom of the thermometer. As the temperature of the thermometer increases, the molecule of the liquid begin to spread out and take up more space. This caused the liquid to move up the thermometer to find more room. The hotter the temperature, the higher the liquid travels up the tube. And in a spring thermometer, a coiled piece of metal end of spring is attached to the pointer. As the air heats, the and the pointer moves higher. As the air cools, the metal contracts and the pointer moves lower. Typically, these types of thermometer are less accurate than bulb or digital thermometers. When you look at a regular outside bulb thermometer, you will see a thin red or silver line that grows longer when it is hotter. The line goes down in cold weather. Now let's move to discuss about shadow. And we will further discuss the opaque object and translucent object. A shadow is an absence of light, which is why shadows are always black. Three things are needed to form shadow: a light source, an opaque or translucent object, and a background to capture the shadow. When the light hits the object, a shadow forms behind the object, where the background remains unlit. So, the characteristics of the cast shadow are dependent on the intensity of the light source. A hard light will produce a cast shadow with a sharp edge. A soft light will produce a cast shadow with a more blurry edge. The longer the cast shadow is formed the object, the softer the edge of the shadow becomes. Notice how the cast shadow is darkest right underneath the sphere, and then it gets lighter and lighter as it goes out further away from the light source. No, light travels in a straight line from its source. When it reaches an opaque solid object, the light is prevented from moving through the object, leaving an area of darkness on the other side, a shadow. If an object is transparent, the light can move through it. If the object is shiny, the light will be reflective on the object. So remember this, a shadow is made when an object blocks the path of a beam of light and creates a dark shape on a surface on the other side of the object. Let's discuss about an opaque object. Opaque objects form clear shadows because no light passes through them. Trees, trunks, human, and chairs are examples of opaque object. So, an opaque object is something that allows no light through it. Concrete, wood, and metal are some examples of opaque materials. Some materials can be opaque to light, but not to other types of electromagnetic waves. The majority of objects are opaque, means can't see through them. This is due to the fact the light can't pass through them. Examples of opaque objects include wood, gold, cement, metal, some types of colored plastic, vegetation, and so on. When light strikes an opaque object, it is either absorbed by the object or it is bounced off or reflected by the object. For example, white objects reflect light, which is why they are cooler to the touch. While dark objects absorb light and transform it into heat, other objects absorb some wavelengths of light while deflecting other. The way that an object reflects light is divided into three groups: transparent, translucent, and opaque. An example of an opaque object is an apple. When we look at an apple, the color reflected is red. This is because all of the other color in the light spectrum are absorbed by the apple. When we see white objects, that means that all of the color in the spectrum are reflected. Another example is wood stores the light that is collected, the thermal energy, fire. Let's discuss about the translucent object and what are some examples of translucent object. So if we talk about the translucent object, a substance is called translucent if it allows partial transmission. Translucent objects cause some light to become scattered onto the background, leaving a shadow that does not represent the exact shape of the object. Transparent objects do not cast shadows. That means light can pass partially through these objects. We cannot see clearly through translucent objects. Any object kept on the other side of the transparent object is not clearly visible. Faint shadow formation in this object doesn't block the light. So translucent objects allow some light to travel through them. Material like frosted glass and some plastics are called translucent. When light strikes translucent material, only some of the light passes through them. The light does not pass directly through the materials. Tinted windows, frosted glass, sunglasses, wax paper, fingers and certain plastics are all examples of translucent objects. Translucent is defined as a material that blurs light as it passes through. Translucency, sometimes known as semi-transparency, is a form of transparency. It allows light to pass through, but unlike a transparent object, it does not allow said light to form shape. That means translucent objects only allow a few amounts of light to pass through it. This material does not follow the law of refraction. Let's discuss about size and position of shadows. The size and position of a shadow change according to the position of light source. If an object is moved closer to the light source, the shadow gets bigger. If an object is moved further away from the light source, the shadow gets smaller. The position of a shadow depends on the position of the light source. As the position of the sun in the sky moves throughout the day, so will the position of the shadow. If the sun is on the right of an object, the shadow will appear on the left. As the sun passes to the left of an object, the shadow moves to the right. So, shadow can also change their shape. As light moves closer, the shadow becomes longer and wider. As light moves away, the shadow becomes shorter and thinner. There are actually at least four factors which affect the size of the shadow: the size of the light source, the size of the object, the distance between the source and the object, the distance between the object and the projection surface. So these are the four factors which affect the size of the shadow. That means to calculate length and direction of a cast shadow, first locate the light source and then locate the point directly beneath the light on the surface plane receiving the cast shadow. Let's discuss about eclipses. Eclipses are caused by shadows. Eclipses occur when a planet, moon, or other celestial objects move between the sun and another planet, moon, or celestial object because the bodies are opaque. They stop sunlight passing through and cast a shadow. An eclipse happens when a planet or a moon gets in the way of the sun's light. Here on Earth, we can experience two kinds of eclipses, solar eclipses and lunar eclipses. A solar eclipse happens when the moon gets in the way of the sun's light and casts its shadow on Earth. That means during the day, the moon moves over the sun and it gets dark. Isn't it strange that it gets dark in the middle of the day? This total eclipse happens about every year and a half somewhere on Earth. A partial eclipse, when the moon doesn't completely cover the sun, happens at least twice a year somewhere on Earth. And during a lunar eclipse, Earth gets in the way of the sun's light hitting the moon. That means that during the night, a full moon fades away as Earth's shadow covers it up. The moon can also look reddish because Earth's atmosphere absorbs the other colors while it bends some sunlight towards the moon. So, sunlight bending through the atmosphere and absorbing other colors is also why sunset are orange and red. During a total lunar eclipse, the moon is shining from all sunrises and sunsets occurring on Earth. Let's discuss about sound and matter. Sound travels in waves, but not all sound waves are the same. Sound waves are measured by their length. Low sounding noises have larger spaces between each crest of the wave than higher sounding noises. Sound is very different from light. Instead of being energy that is released from matter, sound is caused by the movement or vibration of matter, often in the form of compression or pressure waves. We know that sound can pass through the gas because most of the sounds we hear have traveled through the air, which is full of gases. But do you think sound can pass through other matter? Sound can travel through the liquids. If you are understand with a friend and they yell out, you will hear them if you are close to them. Sound can also travel through solids. If you are inside a room and someone knocks on the door, can you hear it? Yes, you can. So we know that sound can travel through solids. So, sound travels more quickly through solids than through liquid and gases because the molecules of a solid are closer together and therefore can transmit the vibrations energy faster. Sound travels most slowly through gases because the molecule of a gas are farthest apart. Sound is a series of compression and refraction waves that can travel long distances. It is produced by the vibration of the particles present in the medium. A medium is the material through which sound can travel. Presence of a medium is a must for the movement of sound waves. Do you know about it? How can we hear a sound? Sound waves enter the outer ear and travel through a narrow passage called the ear canal, which leads to the eardrum. The eardrum vibrates from the incoming sound waves and sends these vibrations to three tiny bones in the middle ear. Bones in the middle ear amplify or intuition and send them to the snail shaped structure filled with fluid in the inner ear. An elastic runs from the end of the upper and lower part. Once the vibration caused the fluid inside to ripple traveling wave from along the basilar membranes, hair cells, sensory cells sitting on the top of the basilar membranes ride the wave. Hair cells near the white and the snail shape detect higher pitch sound, such as infant crying. Those closer to the center detect lower pitch sound, such as a large dog barking. As the hair cells move up and down, microscopic hair-like projections known as the stereocilia that perch on top of the hair cell bump against an overlying structure and bend. Bending cause pore-like channels, which are the tips of the stereocilia, to open up. When that happens, chemical rush into the cells creating an electrical signal. The auditory nerve carries this electrical signal to the brain, which turns into a sound that we recognize and understand. But sound does not travel at the same speed through these three forms of matter. Which one do you think it travels through fastest? Gas, liquid, or solid? No, sound does not travel through gases faster than through liquids or solid. In fact, it travels more slowly through gases than through the other two. Sound travels through water 4 times faster than it travels through air, and it travels through solid even faster. Well, many people think that sound travels in one direction. That's actually just a misconception. People imagine the waves of music that leave their speaker as going out in their straight line or in a conical shape from the speaker. But in order to have sound travel toward a particular area, you would have to physically direct it. The best way to do that is to use something, a tube or a cone, which is why we have a megaphone. Still, most people aren't directing the noise they make in their own home. They are just walking around their apartment, watching movies and living their life as usual. So where does all that sound go? Well, if we want to understand the direction of a sound, we first need to know how it's dispersed. Understanding the various type of noises is the first step to being able to defend against them. While sound moves at a much faster speed in the water than in air, the distance that sound waves travels is primarily dependent upon ocean temperature and pressure. While pressure continues to increase as ocean depth increases, the temperature of the ocean only decreases up to the certain point, after which it remains relatively stable. These factors have a curious effect on how and how far sound waves travel. The area in the ocean where sound waves refract up and down is known as the sound channel, and channeling of sound waves allows sound travel to travel thousands of miles without the signal losing considerable energy. In fact, hydrophones or underwater microphones, if placed at the proper depth, can pick up whale songs and man-made noises from many kilometers away. If you are sitting in a boat, a sound coming from the shore will seem louder than the same sound heard by a person on land. Sound seems to be amplified when it travels over water. The reason is that the water moves the air above its surface, which then slows down the sound waves near the surface. This causes the refraction or bending of the sound wave, such that more sound reaches the boat passenger. Sound waves skimming the surface of the water can add to the amplification effect if the water is calm. Let's discuss about noises and effects. The intensity of sound, how soft or loud it is measured in decibels. The softest sound that can be heard by the human ear measured 0 on the decibel scale. The louder the noise, the more harmful it is for your ears. Not all animals can hear all the same sound. Each sound has a frequency that is measured in units called hertz. The higher the hertz number, the higher the sound. The lower the hertz number, the lower the sound. Noise's health effects are the physical and psychological health consequences of regular exposure to consistent elevated sound
as far
levels.
As loudness is concerned,
noise from traffic in particular is considered by the World Health Organization to be one of the worst environmental stressors for humans, second only to air pollution.
Exposure.
Elevated workplace on environmental noise can cause hearing impairment, hypertension, heart disease, annoyance, and sleep disturbance.
The sound is measured is with
at
a sound
scientific
level.
Sound device and noise are technically the same. They are vibrations in the air or in water.
It the
that
amount
we pick
up
with
particles
our ears.
Being
the bigger
around,
the waves are,
which we
amplitude,
at
the stronger the vibrations
are translated
to
the louder the sound is.
However,
sound
is something that we hear in general. Noise is something that we can hear but don't necessarily
at one point
want to hear.
Time, in other words, it's best
people
for measuring
don't hear
an
all
environment
sounds
that
as
we
has
do, for
a
example,
constant
the
level
sound
of a dog whistle and
can be
inaudible
to
people
but
dogs
can
hear that
sound
we have discussed
to
in
that
marine
area
animals can
over
often hear sound that people can't hear. The sound people hear best are sound like human conversation. Scientists theorize that these animals best hear the sound that they use every day, with their hearing dependent on that frequency and intensity of the sound and individual animals' hearing sensitivity. As we know, people can hear sound at frequencies from about 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz. That we hear sound best from 1,000 Hz to 5,000 Hz, where human speech is centered. Hearing loss may reduce the range of frequencies a person can hear. It's common for people to lose their ability to hear higher frequencies as they get older. The sound intensity that scientists measure is not the same as loudness. Loudness describes how people perceive sound, see loudness. The softness sound that young adult can hear in a frequency range of 1000 Hz to 3000 Hz. Another method is by using a noise. This also has a microphone and recorder attached to it, but is used to record sound levels throughout the day and then averages the total noise someone is exposed to. This is usually attached near someone's ear so it can accurately record the level perceived by the person through the day. This is the best for measuring environments where sound level constantly change and is also measured in dB. So let's discuss about how noises affects on human ear. So here is one chart. Let's discuss about it. This chart shows the hearing range from a number of animal. Human 20 to 20,000 Hz, elephant 5 to 12,000 Hz, dog 50 to 45,000 Hz, cat 45 to 65,000 Hz, mouse 1,000 to 100,000 Hz, bat 2,000 to 120,000 Hz, and beluga whale 1,000 to 120,000 Hz, and dolphin 75 to 150,000 Hz. This is a range. What are the frequencies humans can hear? Sound with frequencies above the realms of humans' ear are called ultrasound, and those below are called infrasound. Though we are capable of distinguishing between 1400 odd pitches, most of the important speech-related sound fall within a narrow, relatively low spectrum. So, the hearing range of human is between 20 and 20,000 Hz. Remember this. There are lots of high sound that dogs, cat, mice, bats, whale and dolphins can hear that human cannot hear. Low sounds that human can hear but dogs, cat, mice, bats, whale and dolphins cannot hear. The human hearing range depends on both the pitch of the sound, whether it is high or low, and the loudness of the sound. Pitch is measured in hertz and the loudness is measured in decibels. For a person with normal hearing, when it comes to pitch, the human hearing range starts low at about 20 hertz, that about the same as the lowest pedal on a pipe organ on the other side of the human hearing range. The highest possible frequency heard without discomfort is 20,000 Hz, while 20 to 20,000 Hz forms the absolute border of the human hearing range. If people could hear equally at all frequencies, the control lines would be flat because the same measured sound intensity would be perceived to be equally loud regardless of the sound frequency. In fact, people do not hear as well as at low frequencies. Therefore, the relative sound intensity has to be much greater for a low frequency sound to be perceived to be as loud as a sound at a frequency that we hear well, such as 1000 Hz. So that means light does not really affect sound. Sound is made of vibrations in air, water, or solid material. Light is made of vibration in the electric and magnetic field. Now, even if light were not so fast, it's hard to see exactly how light could affect sound. The electric and magnetic field associated with typical light beam are much smaller than those from a capacitor or a magnet. So if you wanted them to somehow interact with the vibration of particles in a sound wave, you would probably need a huge laser pointed at the material through which sound was passing. Let's discuss about what is frequency. As you already know, sound travels in waves. Frequency is the number of waves produced in a second. The higher the frequency, the higher the sound. The period of duration of time of a cycle of wave is reciprocal, is divided by of frequency. The S1 unit of frequency is the hertz, which is frequency to the older unit cycle per second, CPS. Frequency is also known as cycles per second or temporal frequency. The usual symbol for frequency are the Latin letter of the Greek letter V, and in the bracket you have to write. That means frequency describes the number of waves that pass a fixed place in a given amount of time. So if the time it takes for a wave to pass is half second, the frequency is 2 per second. If it takes 1 by 100 of an hour, the frequency is 100 per hour. In the most general sense, frequency is defined as the number of times an event occurs per time of time. In physical and chemistry, the term frequency is most often applied to waves, including high sound and light sound. Radio frequency is the number of times a point on a wave passes a fixed reference point in 1 second. Frequency is the number of occurrence of a repeat event per unit of time. It also occasionally referred to as temporal frequency to emphasize, to contrast a spatial frequency, and ordinary frequency to emphasize the contrast to angular frequency. Frequency is measured in hertz, which is equal to 1 event per second. The period is the duration of the time of 1 cycle in a repeating event. So the period is the reciprocal of the frequency. The quantity of frequency is also confused with the quantity speed. The speed of an object refers to how fast an object is moving and is usually expressed as the distance traveled per time of travel. For a wave, the speed is the distance traveled by a given point on the wave, such as a crest, in the given period of the time. So while wave of frequency refer to the number of cycles occurring per second, wave speed refer to the meter travel per second. A wave can vibrate back and forth very frequently. You have a small speed and a wave can vibrate back and forth. while a low frequency yet have a high speed. Frequency and speed are distinctly different quantities. You can see in this chart that, as we know and we have discussed about it, the 20 Hertz high frequency heard human ear. Now 10,000 Hertz for whistle, 1,000 Hertz high note from singer. It will be used for singer, 1,000 Hertz. 100 Hertz low note from singer and 20 Hertz for the drum. Let's repeat quickly about what is frequency. Frequency is the measurement of the number of times that a repeated event occur per unit of time. The frequency of wave-like pattern including sound, electromagnetic waves such as radio light, electrical signals or the waves express the number of cycles of the repetitive wave from per second. In SI unit, the result is measured in Hertz, named after the German physicist Heinrich Rudolf Hertz. 1 Hertz means 1 cycle or wave per second. Frequency has an inverse relationship to the concept of wavelength, the distance between two peaks, such that the frequency is equal to the velocity divided by the wavelength. And wavelength is a distance, so the meter is the SI unit, but wavelength are small, so are typically given in nanometers nm, which is 10⁻⁹ meters. 1 nm is equal to 0.0000001 m. So that was the low note and high note frequency level that human can heard. So we have discussed about in this chapter light, sound, heat. Now, did you know that the decibel is named after Alexander Graham Bell, who invented one of the first telephones? So that's it for today. We have learned sound, wave, light, heat. I hope you like this video. Don't forget to subscribe my channel and press bell icon button. Thank you so much for liking this video.